For the next hour, we have a very important visitor to New York City in the studio with us who is going to speak with you. He is Sheikh Muzaffer Effendi, visiting here from Istanbul with his dervishes. And I urge people who are listening to call their friends. It's a rare opportunity to hear a true representative of Islam speak. Someone who has had the full lifetime training in the arts and sciences and language and philosophy and mystical traditions of Islam. Last week we began this discussion talking with listeners over the air about the lack of true friendship between Western cultures and Islamic cultures. And not just a matter of an information gap or a scholarship gap, but a friendship gap. And Sheikh Muzaffer is here in New York City to help remedy that situation. And he does this by inviting everyone in the entire city to come to one of the largest cathedrals in the world, St. John the Divine, which is at 113th in Amsterdam in Manhattan, and participate in the ancient dervish ceremony of zikr, the remembrance of God. He was there last Tuesday evening and will be there again day after tomorrow, Tuesday evening at 8 o'clock. And I stress that there is no charge for that, because it's the offering of the Helveti Jerrahi order and an offering of the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, an offering to the greater friendship between Christians, Jews, Muslims, the greater friendship between lovers of truth. While you're calling a friend, which would be an interesting way to increase the listenership and make use of this opportunity that we have in this electronic field that exists 90 miles, that stretches 90 miles in every direction from the Empire State Building. If you will each call a friend in order to establish the atmosphere, one of the hafizes or who have traveled here from Istanbul with the Sheikh, these are men who know the Holy Quran by heart and have since childhood, will chant a few ayats from the Holy Quran. For those of you who are unaware of the way the living tradition of Islam regards Quran, the sound of the Arabic Quran is itself contains healing power, the power to awaken the heart, to illuminate the spirit, to make differences and limits dissolve and allow the human being to turn toward the ultimate source. All this simply by the power and the resonance of the words, not even by knowing the literal meaning of the word. So this in itself will be a gift to everyone listening. Take your telephone off the hook after you've finished calling your friend. Turn down your lights. Change your mood. And be receptive to this resonance, which for 14 centuries has resonated from this planet, from every nation on this planet, and which Allah promises in Quran will be here until the end of time. It's not going anyplace. So we should make friends with it. The next voice you hear will be that of one of the dervishes of Sheikh Muzaffer chanting Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون نزلا من غفور رحيم ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا وقال إنني من المسلمين ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم صدق الله العظيم
That was not from a record or a tape. That was an actual living individual here in the studios of WBAI in New York City, making the sacred act of chanting Quran, which is at the very heart of the cohesion and the beauty and the mercy of Islamic civilizations. And which, by its very feeling, by its very ambiance, can almost show you immediately that what you read in the newspapers and what you, the superficial kind of treatment that one gets of Islamic civilization is completely off the mark. This Hafiz Kemal and the other dervishes, as I said earlier, will chant Quran and invoke the beautiful names of Allah at St. John the Divine Cathedral this Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. Everyone is welcome without any charge. The cathedral is at 113th Street and Amsterdam Avenue. Also, and I'll mention this at the end of the program, on Friday evenings, down on Mercer Street in Soho, the Shaykh invites people to come to his tekka, his meeting place, in order to have sohbet, in order to have further instruction and conversation about the truth. So that's about 8 o'clock on, or 8:30 on Friday evenings. The address is 155 Mercer Street, just south of Houston. Sheikh Muzaffer, who are the true Muslims?
Kimler hakiki Müslümanlardır?
Rabbimiz Allah diyen ve hakkıyla Allah'a bağlanan, sonra istikamet üzerine bulunan kimseler hakiki Müslümandır.
True Muslims are those who call Allah as their Lord, who keep their direction, istikamet,
güzel bulunanlardır.
Eyvallah.
Bu soru çok cevabı icap ettiren bir sorudur. Bizim vereceğimiz mana, denizden bir katre, güneşten bir hüzme, kainattan bir zerredir yani vereceğimiz mana.
This question requires many an answer.
Bir tarifi de, hakiki Müslümanın kendini layık gördüğünü halka layık görendir. Bir tarifi de, halkın onun elinden ve dilinden halas olan, kötülük görmeyen kimsedir.
So any present answers that can be given are like drops of water from oceans and a beam of light from sun or any particle taken at random from the universe. Other possible descriptions of a Muslim are someone who wishes for others what good he wishes for himself, and someone from whose hands and whose tongue others are safe from.
Yine hakiki Müslüman, Allah'ın emirlerini seve seve yapan ve Allah'ı seven ve Allah'ın celalinden korkarak Allah'ın yasaklarından kaçınandır.
Again, a true Muslim is a person who obeys the injunctions of Allah lovingly, without feeling compulsion, and avoids sins.
Evet, vermiş olduğumuz cevaplar gayet basit olarak soruya karşı, ancak radyoda ve böyle bir oturumda verilecek cevaplardı yani. Yoksa bunun üzerine büyük cilt cilt kitaplar yazılabilir.
Well, on the subject, many a book could be written, but the answers that were available at the moment were answers that could be given in such a session, in a radio program, or in private conversation. But many books could be actually written on the subject.
Yine hakiki Müslüman.
Again, a true Muslim.
Gayb olarak Allah'a inanan ve Allah'ı çok yakın bilen ve Allahü Teala Hazretlerine ibadet eden ve rızkından fukarayı yediren ve içiren, kendinden evvel kitaplara iman eden ve kendine inzal olunan kitabı tasdik eden, kimselerdir ki bunlar işte felaha ve necata bunlar ermiştir. Ki hakiki Müslümandır.
And true Muslims are those people who believe in Allah without seeing Allah and believing the books descended from Allah. Gayba iman ederler, kitaplara inanırlar.
Kitaplar, yani kendilerine evvel gelen kitaplara inanırlar.
Devrat'a, İncil'e, Zebur'a
ve Kur'an'a inanırlar.
That have descended before the Quran, like the Torah and the
New Testament. Ve aynı zamanda
and at the same time,
rızıklarından fukarayı rızıklandırırlar.
And are those people who sustain the poor with which they had received in the first place, like they sustained the poor with the sustenance they received from Allah.
So among Jews and among Christians there are true Muslims.
Yani bu şu manaya gelir mi ki efendim Museviler ve Hristiyanlar arasında hakiki Müslümanlar bulunsun?
Elbet.
Surely.
Onlar da Muhammed Aleyhisselam'ı kabul ederlerse onlar da hakiki bir Müslümandır. Biz onların inandıklarına inanıyoruz. Müminler. Yani bir mümin, bir Müslim Hazreti İsa'nın Allah'ın peygamberi olduğuna, Meryem'in kutsi bir kadın olduğuna ve İncil'in Allah kitabı olduğuna inanır. Ve aynı zamanda Musa peygamberi tasdik eder. Tevrat'ı tasdik eder. Onun üzerine de Kur'an'ı tasdik eder. Hazreti Muhammed tasdik eder. Hakkıyla mümin olur. Budur.
Surely they can be considered as Muslims and good Muslims at that. But the thing is, the Prophet Muhammad, may Allah's peace and blessing be upon him, has to be recognized. And belief in prophecy of Jesus, may Allah's peace be upon him, and belief in the purity, in the holiness of Mary is to be recognized and affirmed.
İş böyle olunca bir Müslüman hem Müsevidir, hem İsevidir, hem Muhammedidir. Öyleyse İsa'ya tabi olan Aleyhisselam, Hazreti Musa'ya tabi olan da Hazreti Muhammed ve Kur'an'ı tasdik ederse mümin olur, hiç arada itilaf kalmaz.
You see, when that is the case, actually a Muslim is a Christian and a Jew at the same time, with the confirmation or the prophecy of Muhammad the Prophet, may Allah's peace be upon him, there is actually no difference between a Jew and a Christian and a Muslim.
O vakit tevhide birleşmiş oluruz ki fırkalar birleşir, tevhide varır.
Then we are united within unity.
İnsanlıkta ve eşkelde birbirimize benzediğimiz gibi itikatta birbirimize benzeriz ve tam bir tevhid meydana gelir.
Being humans, we share a form, the human appearance, and at the same time, we would be in unity and sharing belief as well.
Evet.
Yes.
Bilmem benim cevaplarım kendisini tatmin ediyor mu?
I don't know whether my answers are satisfactory from your point of view.
Ve anlatmak istediğimi acaba anlatabiliyor muyum?
Am I passing through what I would like to express?
It's remarkable the universality that Islam has, because you've said not only are there true Muslims among Jews and Christians, but you've made a more radical statement that there really is no essential difference between the three great religions, and that a Muslim is per se a Jew and a Christian.
Efendicim, burada son derece şayanı dikkat olan bir husus var. İslamiyet'in ne kadar cihan şumul olduğunu belirttikten sonra
evet.
Hem Musevilerin ve Hristiyanların nasıl daire-i İslamiyet'e dahil olduklarını veya olabileceklerini, hem de Müslümanların aynı zamanda Musevi ve Hristiyan adlandırılabileceklerini belirtmiş olmakla son derece yeni ve yenilik arz eden bir konuyu ortaya koymuş oluyorsunuz.
Elbette öyle. Her Müslüman, bugünkü durumda her Müslüman hem Musevidir, hem İsevidir, hem Muhammedidir. Çünkü bir Müslüman İsa'yı inkar ederse, ya İncil'i inkar ederse, yahut Tevrat'ı inkar ederse, yahut Hazreti Musa'yı inkar ederse, o adam Müslüman olmaz, mümin sayılmaz. Okuduğum, Semih Demir'in az evvel beyan etmiş olduğum cevap, Sure-i Kur'aniye'nin Sure-i Bakara'da olan bir kısmını Allah'ın nasıl tarif ettiğini aynen tercüme ettim, size söyledim.
Actually, without actually being a Jew and a follower of Jesus, and at the same time a Mohammedan, a follower of the Prophet Muhammad, may Allah have peace upon him, a person cannot be considered a Muslim. A Muslim has to have faith in the Quran, as well as the Torah, the Bible, the New Testament, and Jesus the Prophet. And these are not my words, actually. This is what Allah mentions in His holy book, the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter, which I was trying to deliver in concise form.
So it's not, this is not a liberal, a product of a liberal modern point of view, that this universality was taught directly from the original Quran.
Yani bu İslam'ın cihan şumul olması yeni, modern, hür, geniş düşünceli bir zihniyetin eseri değil, bidayetinden beri, kaynaktan beri İslamiyet bu kadar geniş bir...
La şek ve la şüphe. Biz yalnız ehli kitabı haber verdik. Tevrat'ı ve İncil'i ve İncil eshabını ve Tevrat eshabını haber verdik. Velev ki Budist olsa, Allah'a, peygambere, kıyamet gününe inandı mı, amal-i saliha icra etti mi, mümin olur o. Yani onun Budist olması İslam'a girmesine mani değildir.
Eyvallah Efendimiz. Oh, without doubt, this surely you saw, Islam has always been universal. This is not simple a radical point of view. It was universal from the source. And so far, we have only mentioned what we call the people of the book, namely the Jews and the Christians. What we've been saying holds true for others, others as well. Take, for an example, a Buddhist would believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment and the prophets. A Buddhist is welcome in the Muslim community as well as anyone else.
Ve aynı zamanda Sabi'yi olsun. Yani Sabi'yi olsun.
Even a pagan.
Budist olsun.
A star worshipper.
Efendim,
a Buddhist.
Diğer din salikleri. Yahut la dini olsun. Allah'a inanmamış.
People are...
İnsan olsun ama Allah'a ve Resulüne inansın. Yevmi kıyamete iman etsin, amal-i saliha, güzel işleri işlesin Allah'ın dediklerini, onun cennete geleceği muhakkaktır.
Even a pagan, a fire worshipper, someone who worships the stars, anyone who follows any religion can be a Muslim on the condition that he or she believes in Allah, his prophets, the Day of Judgment, and in addition to that, if he performs good deeds, he's bound to enter paradise. There are no other requirements.
Bu eskiden beri böyleydi ve kıyamete kadar da böyle olacaktır. Ama İslam'ın aleyhinde konuşanlar İslam'ı bilmeyenlerdir.
This has been so from the very beginning, and this will be so till the day of judgment, and those who speak against Islam are those people who don't actually know what Islam is.
Benim temas ettiğim bazı cemaatler ki onlar yani tesadüfi böyle kendileriyle konuştuk. Bir takım Hristiyanlarla bizi İsa'nın düşmanı, Hazreti Meryem'in düşmanı, İncil'in düşmanı biliyorlar. Halbuki öyle bir şey yok. Her Müslüman İncil'i ve Tevrat'ı ve Hazreti Musa'yı ve İsa'yı ve Hazreti Adem'e kadar giden peygamberlerin cümlesine iman eder. Hiçbirini tekzip etmez, yalanlamaz.
I've come across and met certain people quite accidentally, like Christians who thought Muslims and Islam are adversaries of Jesus the Prophet, and they simply didn't have any belief in him or were hostile towards Mary and did not take any interest in the Bible. And this is a totally distorted viewpoint.
İnsanlar Hazreti Adem'den ve İbrahim'den hep kardeştirler.
You see, a Muslim believes in all the prophets, starting with Adam, the first man, the first prophet, in all the holy books. And mankind are brothers from Adam on and from Abraham on.
Din anlayışından dolayı birbirlerinin kardeşliklerini unutmuşlardır.
And they have forgotten that they are brothers because of different understandings of the religion.
İşte Kur'an'ın gelmesi, Hazreti Muhammed'in bağışlanması, aklarından gönderilmesi bu kardeşliği hatırlatarak bütün insanlar birbirinin kardeşi olup bir erkekle bir kadından meydana geldiğini, kabile kabile, şube şube, millet millet ayrıldığını, fakat hiçbir kabilenin diğer kabileye, hiçbir milletin diğer millete bir eftaleti olmayıp ancak Allah'tan korku ile ayrıldığı ve Allah indinde kerim olan, haktan korkan ve Allah'a seven olduğunu Allah Kur'an'da haber vermekte.
As we said, people who are actually brothers and sisters have been separated from each other because of different understandings, different interpretations of religion, the religion, and the reason for the descent of the Holy Quran and the mission of the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, may Allah have peace and peace upon him, is to unify all people, all creeds, and erase, get rid of all differences, all major differences in interpretation or the religion. Mankind are descendants of Adam, and they were divided into tribes, clans, nations, but Islam teaches us all that there are no basic differences between any people, any groups of people. They're all equal to each other, and any superiority that can exist is in the form of being closer to Allah, obeying Him. In any other sense, there's no distinction, there's no superiority, so to speak.
Allah Subhanahu ve Teala Hazretleri birdir. En büyük günah Allah'a şirk koşmaktır.
Allah is one. There is no God, no divinity but Allah. And the greatest sin is setting partners to Him.
Allah şirkten gayri dilediği günahı affedebilir.
Allah may forgive any sin if He wishes to do so, apart from shirk, which is setting partners to Him, setting up false deities.
Ehl-i Kitab ile Müslümanların arasındaki bulunan itilaf şudur.
The only difference between Muslims and people of the book, as we call them, namely Christians and Jews is...
Müsemmada değil, esmada ihtilaf vardır. Türk Tanrı demiş, Arap Allah demiş, İngiliz God demiş, Alman God demiş, efendim Fransız Dio demiş, Farisi Huda demiş. İsimleri değişiyor. Yoksa müsemma bir. Onun la şerike leh, la ilahe illallah, la şerike leh, onun şeriki yoktur, naziri yoktur. Bir tanedir, doğmamıştır, doğurmamıştır, hiçbir şeye mühtaç değildir, hiç benzeri yoktur, küfü yoktur. En güzel odur. Ondan başka da bir şey yoktur. La mevcudu illa hu.
The difference is not in the reality, the truth that's named with names, so on. There's no difference. There cannot possibly be any other reality that's mentioned.
Just to let people who've tuned in, possibly hearing the sound of the Turkish and sound of the deep bass voice of Sheikh Muzaffer, program is in the spirit, and we're speaking in the WBAI studios this evening with Sheikh Muzaffer Effendi from Istanbul, who is a dervish sheikh, an imam, a scholar, a devout Muslim, and also an expert in rare Qurans and rare ancient manuscripts. And he's made the effort to come with his dervishes all the way from Istanbul, and made the effort to come right to the studio in order to speak directly to New York City about the nature of Islam and the terrible mistake that people are making who are separating Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, or in fact who are separating humanity into any sort of categories of inferior and superior. On Tuesday evening, day after tomorrow, at 8 o'clock at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, Sheikh Muzaffer and his dervishes actually demonstrate experientially the point which he was just making philosophically, that there is one reality which is called God or Dieu or Allah, or countless other words in all cultures have had words for the ultimate truth. And he and his dervishes gather, and they make a circle, and they begin to evoke the power of this one reality. And people who come actually experience this power. It's no longer a textbook statement. It's no longer possibly an anthropological speculation about the similarities of structure between cultures. It's a direct experience that everyone can have. Later in the evening, the audience is actually invited to join the dervishes. So there's not even any separation maintained between dervish and non-dervish. It's certainly none between Muslim and non-Muslim. It's the true Muslims are gathering there, whatever cultural dress they may have. Sheikh Muzaffer, when you invoke the Living One in Zikr and St. John the Divine, what really happens? What actually happens at that moment?
Bu şu meseleyi de izah edelim, sonra bana soruyu sorun.
Okay, there's this point that we'll have to explain first, then you can go on with your question if you please.
Ehl-i kitap arasındaki ihtilaf şuna benziyor.
The conflict that apparently exists between people of the book.
Bir İngiliz, bir Alman, bir Türk, bir Faris, bir Arap ve hepsi bir araya toplandılar.
Is like in an example, we take samples from various nations that we have: an Englishman, a Turk, an Arab, a Persian. Fransız da var mıydı efendim?
Fransız yok, Alman. Fransız da var ama yani bir kadar kafi.
Well, that'll be sufficient.
Evet, toplandılar.
They're all together.
Arap dedi ki, zebib alalım.
And the Arab said, let's buy zebib, whatever it is.
Türk dedi ki, yok, zebib almayalım, üzüm alalım.
And the Turkish man said, no, we're not going to buy zebib, but let's buy üzüm instead.
İngiliz dedi ki, krep alalım.
The Englishman said, let's buy some grapes.
Alman dedi ki yok, krebe almayalım, wine turbe alalım.
And the German said, no, we're not gonna buy, what was the last thing, grapes? We're not gonna go for grapes, let's buy wine turbe.
Faris dedi ki, engür alalım.
And the Persian said, let's buy engür.
Ve kavga ettiler yani bu. Hani benim dediğim olacak, senin dediğin olacak.
And they went into dispute, they were fighting each other.
Sonra,
afterwards,
yüzümü görünce hepsi dedi ki istediğimiz buymuş. İsimler ayrılmıyor.
And actually,
bedava kavga etmişler yani.
Grapes appeared on the scene. They said, well, that's what we wanted initially. And we argued and fought each other over nothing. That's what we had wanted in the first place.
Ha, mücadelemiz lügat üzereymiş demek ki.
So,
müsemma bir.
So, our
bunun gibi,
fight,
buna
our quarrel was semantic, linguistic in nature. Well, this is a simile.
So it's St. John the Divine. Efendi actually has the grapes there.
Efendicim, katedralde üzümleri Haziruna ikram ediyorlar diyor. Şimdi deminki sorusu bu Esna-i Zikrullah'ta mesela katedralde yapılacak olan ayinde
evet.
Allah-u Teala'yı her zaman diri manasına gelen hay ismi
evet.
ile zikrettiğimiz zaman ne oluyor, ne meydana, ne husule geliyor?
Biz de hay oluyoruz da ondan.
And we become ever living as well.
Ölü kalplerimiz diriliyor.
Our hearts that have been long dead are revived, resurrected.
Biz Allah'a hay dedikçe, çünkü Allah'ı zikredeni Allah zikreder. Biz Allah'ın hay esmasını okudukça hay, hay, hay, hay, hay. Allah da bize ne yapıyor? Mukabilinde aynen hay, hay, hay diye cevap veriyor ve ölü kalplerimizi diriltiyor.
You see, when we invoke and recite the name of Allah during the ceremony of remembrance, Allah remembers and invokes us too. When we invoke Him by the name Hay, which is ever living, Allah invokes us in the same way, in our hearts that have been dead are revived.
Allah'ı zikirden güzel bir şey olabilir mi dünyada? Yani sevgililiği zikretmekten daha güzel bir şey olur mu?
Could there be anything that's more beautiful than remembering and invoking the name of Allah? Could there be anything?
Allah hem mabuttur hem de mahbubtur. Sevilmeye de layıktır.
Could there be anything more beautiful than invoking the beloved Allah? Is the worshipped and at the same time is the beloved.
Dikkat ederseniz ben katedralde veyahut umumi yerde zikrettiğim vakitte hiç ne mezhep ne din fark etmeden herkesi Allah demeye çağırırım.
Well, I would like to point out that when I'm performing the zikr ceremony, the ceremony and the ritual of remembrance, I, without differentiating between religions, and sects and differences of belief, call any and everyone present to remember and invoke Allah by various names with us, together with us.
Bu hususta ben şunu söylerim. Tanımazam mezhep, bilmezem ayin, kiliseyi aşkın mesihasıyım. Şeyh Nikâl Hazretleri'ni.
We can actually recite a small stanza on this point, and which is Efendi's opinion. I don't recognize any sects, nor any rituals. I am the Messiah of the Church of Love.
Her şey Allah'ı zikretmekte. Cemadat olsun, nebatat olsun, hayvan olsun, insan olsun, varlığı Allah'ı zikreder. Çok mudur ki her şeyi hakkı zikrederse insan ki bütün mahlukatına eftaledir. Onun hakkı zikretmesi kadar âlâ bir şey olur mu?
Everything that has been created invokes and remembers Allah in their own special ways, be they so-called inorganic matter, plants, animals, and all. If that be the case, is it too much to ask that the human being, which is the most honored, most valuable, and the most precious outcome of creation, is asked to remember and invoke Allah?
Allah'ı zikretmenin zevkine varanlar Allah'ı zikreder.
Only those who get a taste, who find out about the taste of remembering, invoking Allah, actually do so.
Ne yapalım ki maalesef herkes o zevke nail olamaz.
But unfortunately, everybody cannot taste this supreme pleasure, so to speak.
Burada muhalif beyan zannetmeyin. Muhalif beyan diye insan istek ve arzusuyla insana bir irade verilmiştir. İstek ve arzusuyla Allah'ı zikreder. Yoksa Allah'ı zikretmeyen insanın vücudu da Allah'ı zikreder.
The listeners should not reach the conclusion that there was a contradiction involved in what was being said, like plants and animals invoking Allah and the human beings not being capable of doing so. But actually, there are two types of remembrance, one being involuntary, the body, the whole organism, the whole creature, remembering and invoking Allah in ways that we don't know. But what we were talking about, what we were inviting people over to do, is this invocation that comes out of our own will with a taste attached to it.
Allah da zikreder çünkü. Allah da zikreder.
Allah also remembers and invokes.
Feskuruni eskurukum diyor Kur'an'da.
As it said in the
beni zikredin gibi
ben zikredeyim
diyor.
Remember me so that I'll remember you, or invoke me, invoke my names and I'll invoke yours.
Evet efendim.
Yes sir.
Biriniz.
So the people who come to the ceremony of zikr at St. John the Divine, well, actually, the Shaykh is assuring us that people who come with sincerity in their heart and listen to the invocation of the Divine and participate in any way they want to, even simply by watching, will actually have the taste of the grapes. And then the argument about what to call the grapes will gradually disappear from the mind and heart. This argument is an old one. It goes back thousands of years, so we can't expect it to disappear instantly. But you don't have to translate all this. The real demonstration which the dervishes make of the reality of God and the taste of God is a direct experience. It doesn't rely on reasoning or speculation. And in fact, maybe I could ask this to the Shaykh. Isn't it true that the dervishes or lovers of Allah have always served this purpose for whatever society they've been in, to actually give the taste of the experience of Allah to the society?
Deal with the taste?
No, to give the taste, because every society needs that direct taste.
Efendim diyorlar ki her zaman ve her cemiyette dervişlerin vazifesi bu zevki, zikrullah'ın zevkini insanlara aşılamak, tattırmak olmamış mıdır? Bir de daha önce bir soru sormuşlardı. Yani evet. Efendimiz bizi temin ediyorlar mı ki bu katedraldeki zikrullah'a inne gelecek olanlar oradaki üzümleri tadacaklar?
Elbet. Hiç şüphe yok. Allah diye mahrum olmaz çünkü.
Well, the answer to the initial question is whether people who come to the cathedral will be able to taste the grapes surely.
Üzüm değil, şarap diyor.
And it's not actually grapes. It's wine made out of grapes, spiritual wine. To an extent, I mean. And...
Aşk, şarap aşkın remzidir.
Wine, allegorically speaking, is a symbol for love.
Saki de yani verici, veren, dolduran şeyhtir.
And the person who distributes, gives the wine, is the şeyh.
Kadeh de aşıkların vücududur.
And the cup is the body of the lover, lover of truth, the seeker.
Bir kimse zehri inkar etse, çok dikkat edin lütfen, bir kimse zehri inkar etse, bu adama zehir tesir etmez mi?
You see, if a person ignores and denies the effects of poison, would that person be affected by drinking poison or not?
Bir adam takliden de Allah dese, takliden de Allah dese, işte zehrin tesirini inkar eden gibidir. Ama muhakkak zehir onu ne yapar? Yahut şarabın sekri onu sarhoş eder. Onun gibi.
You see, a person who participates in the ceremony, in the ritual of remembrance, even if he or she is like the person who would deny the effects of poison, claiming that he would not be poisoned by drinking a certain liquid, is in the same predicament, actually. I mean, it doesn't matter whether he believes or doesn't believe. It doesn't matter if he's doing it sincerely or just imitating others who are doing it. But actually, poison is not the perfect example. It's more like wine of love that should give us drunkenness.
Zira taklitten tahkike gidilir.
One reaches sincerity through going a stage of imitation.
Şirkten vahdete gidilir.
Unity is only to be attained after a stage of setting partners to Allah.
Riyadan ihlasa varılır.
And sincerity, true sincerity, is only reached after hypocrisy.
Aşk-ı mecaziden aşk-ı hakikaya gidilir. Oradan yol vardır.
True love is to be attained after allegorical love.
Bunların için söylüyorum. Kiliseye toplanacak olan aşıklar bu işi taklide de yapsalar öyle taklide gideceklerdir. Boş dönmeyecekler yani.
The reason why I've been given these examples is that those who come to the cathedral and join us in the performance of the ceremony of remembrance might be there only imitating. But this is the only way they can reach truth only by imitating.
So if there were any people who considered themselves atheists but were courageous enough to actually come and participate in the zikr as an experiment, is it possible that they would have a genuine experience of the divine?
Şimdi soru şu ki efendim, orada kendilerini Allah'ı tanımaz haddeden kimseler gelip de sadece merak sahikiyle gelip de gene merak sahikiyle zikrullah'a katılsalar gene de bir tadbir lezzet alırlar mı?
Muhakkak.
Surely yes, they would.
Az önce söyledim ya.
As we said before.
Zehrin tesirini inkar etmek zehirden onu kurtaramaz. Yahut şarabın sekrini inkar eden bir adam şarabı içtiğinde sekirden kendini kurtaramaz.
A man who drinks poison will be affected by it. So will the man who drinks wine.
This is a tremendous promise that the dervish tradition can make with their ceremony of zikrullah. Can you imagine this kind of promise that even someone who has completely sincere doubts about the existence of ultimate reality will still experience it. I don't know if this genuine promise could be. I didn't think this kind of genuine promise could be made in the 20th century in America. And I'm so moved that Sheikh Muzaffer and his dervishes have come and have made this promise.
Kim olursa olsun, gelenlerden korkmayız. Gelmeyenlere üzülürüz. Gelen mutlaka bir şey alacaktır.
You see, we're not frightened of
gelmeyen de
people who olacaktır. Come and join us there. Because people who come and join us there will take something, will part away with something taken from us, no matter how small it can be. But we're sorry about those who wouldn't come and join us, because they'll be missing something. And they still wouldn't know. They still haven't tasted.
So, once again, I, not simply as an announcement of an event, but as you can see, something much more profound, possibly a turning point in our modern scientific secular experience. I invite everyone who, within the sound of this voice, to come to St. John the Divine at 113th in Amsterdam this Tuesday evening at 8 o'clock or 7:30, and participate in this experience, and test the promise that the Sheikh Muzaffer has offered. And he hasn't offered it personally. It's a promise which comes from the very beginning of Islam, and from the very beginning of humanity. We'd like to end the program with the call to prayer, because since our transmission goes from the top of the Empire State Building, by calling the prayer from that point, it becomes probably the largest minaret in the world, the largest minaret in human history. And this call itself is a call to the heart and mind of humanity to turn around to its source, which is always there. And please heed this call. Come to the dervishes, come to all the lovers of truth, no matter what tradition you find them in. Come and give them a chance to actually demonstrate the experience directly. Also, Friday evening, if you want to continue the conversation further with Sheikh Muzaffer, he invites you to his house at 155 Mercer Street, down in Soho. Come have a cup of tea, a cookie, a cigarette, and discuss further. So the next sound that you will hear will be another one of the Hafizes that have come with Sheikh Muzaffer, chanting the call to prayer. This call to prayer is chanted 5 times a day in the entire Islamic world, which geographically permeates the entire globe, and it's usually connected with the position of the sun. As the prayers become due, the sun is in different positions. So you can imagine the planet with the sun, as the planet spins and the sun moves its position around and around the planet, constantly igniting this call to prayer. And it has for 14 centuries. And the promise is, of Allah is, that it will happen until the end of time.
Allahu Ekber, Allahu Ekber. Allahu Ekber, Allahu Ekber. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا
Muhammeden Resulullah. Hayya alessalâh.
Prayer that you just heard was not from a tape or a record. It was not recorded by some ethnomusicologist someplace in the Middle East. This was coming directly from the WBAI studios. It was being transmitted from our transmitter on the top of the Empire State Building. It was given by one of the beautiful, sweet-voiced Turkish hafizes, which are known all over the world of Islam for the sweetness of their chanting. This is happening in New York City. The sacred traditions, the ancient traditions, are alive. And Islam, after 14 centuries, is full of life and freshness, love and sweetness, and has a rich mystical tradition, of which Sheikh Muzaffer is an exponent. We didn't have a chance to talk too much about the mystical path. We hope that you will continue this conversation with the Sheikh at his house at 155 Mercer Street this Friday evening. And certainly all of you, your Muslim friends, your Christian Jewish friends, your friends who consider themselves to be atheists, everybody should join and drink the wine of love together this Tuesday night at St. John the Divine, the beloved disciple of the beloved Jesus, St. John. He would be very pleased, is very pleased, that this love would be poured out there for everyone. This Tuesday night at 8 p.m., 113th in Amsterdam in Manhattan, let's fill up this gigantic cathedral and make a statement to the world about the unity of humanity. Sheikh Muzaffer, thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.